fucking hoes and popping pillies, man, I feel just like a rock star. All my brothers got that gas and they always be smoking like a rock star. Fucking with me, call up on no Uzi and show up, man, them the shot toss. When my homies pull up on your block, they make that thing go gratatata. Ay, ay, switch my whip, came back in black, I'm starting saying rest in peace to Bon Scott. That door, we blowin' smoke. She asked me light a fire like a Mars song. Ay. Act a fool on stage, probably leave my fucking show in a cop car. Ay. Shit was legendary through a TV out the window of the montage.
What's up, guys? It's your boy Knockout 360 here, and as you can tell, we are in something different. This is not a Dodge. This ain't Mopar at all. But it is something just as, if not more powerful than damn near all Mopars out there, man. But in all honesty, I am in a 2018 Ford Mustang, man. And this is a GT, right?
Yeah, yeah.
I got my man here.
Hey, 2018 GT.
2018 GT, man. So clearly you can tell that this is not a stock GT whatsoever. Talk to me, man. What have you done to it so far?
So I got the car back in last April. First thing I put on was rims and tires. I knew I was going to ultimately need a bigger tire, and the stock rims were only like, I think, 9 inches or whatnot. Gotcha. So I put the RTR Tech 7 wheels. I kept the factory 19-inch size. Went one size bigger in the front to a 265. I'm running 325s on the rear, and those stick pretty good. It's the next best thing without having to go street radials, I feel like. The power's definitely putting down to the street a lot better since I switched from 305s to 325s.
And what do you got up front?
Up front, so I threw on the RTR grill with the lights.
Gotcha.
My second mod for the car was actually the Corsa Extreme full catback. I'm still running stock headers. Other than a bunch of cosmetic stuff, that's all the car's got. I did opt for the 10-speed automatic transmission that was new for the 2018 Mustangs. I don't think it was new to the Camaro ZL1s or the Ford Raptor, but they did introduce it to the Mustang and the 18 models. Other than that, I'm running Pro Chargers HO high output kit. It's a P1SC head unit, which is their smallest head unit, but I'm running the Stage 2 intercooler. ID 1050 injectors, Vortec fuel pump boost, and colder plugs, obviously.
This man has done so much stuff to his Mustang, it's ridiculous, man. This is the furthest thing from a stock Mustang as you can get, man. So you said the front of your car with the lights,
yes,
that's an entire grill insert, correct?
It is,
that's
yeah.
Not just lights.
No, it's not just lights. Now, they do have some that I believe are, if I'm not mistaken, but when I saw this, like I said, RTR makes it. They make a bunch of great products. I've got some of their little exterior bits on here as well, but as well as my rims.
Yeah.
But they make a great product. I fell in love with that grill when I saw it because I felt like it stood out, added a little more aggressiveness to the front end.
Yeah, exactly. You don't see many Mustangs with that at all. I think I've seen two or three maybe in Charlotte with those lights up front. You know what I'm saying? So that definitely distinguishes you from the rest of everyone else, man.
And then the tail lights. Can't
I was about to say, those tail lights have caused so much drama and controversy.
I think so.
Didn't you post a picture on Instagram and people went crazy?
It happens. I mean, some people love it and you know, want to know where I found them. And I've seen a couple more floating around out there with them.
So what are they? So, I mean, explain the process.
So when I first got the car and started looking on different websites or whatnot to see what was out there for these cars, because this is my first Mustang, I think a company called Raxium, if I'm not mistaken, makes some. And I liked them, but I don't want to say I saw bad reviews, but I wanted to see if another product would come out. Well, a company called Miramoto, which manufactures the ones I have, got very good ratings on waterproofing and whatnot. They're a factory fit, just a bolt on. It takes literally 15 minutes to unplug and unscrew the factory ones and pop in those. And really, I think all in all, they're supposed to resemble the Ford GT.
Gotcha.
Model taillights.
Not the Ferraris, the Ford GTs.
Not the Ferraris.
Everybody calls them Ferrari lights. Everybody in our car club calls them Ferrari lights.
Yes.
Not the Ferraris, the Ford GT.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Yep.
Gotcha, man. So what was the process behind doing that? Because they come stock with the three lights on each side, right?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So really, I mean, all it is literally getting into the trunk, kind of pulling back the trunk liner a little bit.
Yeah.
It's like three bolts. Pop those off. You unplug the factory harness from it, or the factory plug from its harness, and you literally pull it out and pop those all come as one more piece.
Oh shit!
And you
that
literally
easy.
Yes, you pop them on, put the three bolts back on the back end, and plug in the harness, and you're good to go.
That's crazy,
so,
man. Because
so for the people that don't like them, I can change them out real quick.
So you still got the original?
I do. They're boxed up, brand new too.
Damn. So let's talk about the power, man. Yeah. What are we putting down realistically here? What do you think? I mean, what should it be putting down? Talk to me.
Realistically, I think I'm more than confident at mid 660s to the tire.
Shit.
I got it dynoed when I first got it, and we were still in like the big tune revision stages because I'm doing a remote tune, even though I'm doing dyno pulls for the tune. That first set of dyno pulls, I was getting robbed of a lot of timing and a lot, and probably losing a little over 100 horsepower, and the car still put on its first dyno run over 550 to the tires. And since then, we've done a lot of revisions to the tune. I haven't got it dynoed again. That's definitely in the near future, but from what I've been told from Pro Dyno as well as the Pro Charger Tech people online, that this thing should easily be making anywhere between 660s, even 680-ish on 93 pump gas.
That's crazy.
So
I mean,
perfect
perfect
street driver. It's my daily driver.
So you do dailies?
So, this is my daily. So wow. That's why I went with the Pro Charger kit. The torque curve's a lot similar to the torque curve of a turbo.
Yeah.
So you don't get that instant... you know, like Griff. Griff drove my car for a little bit, and he's got the ZL1.
Yeah.
And those Root style superchargers, you know, they're instant power right off the bat.
Yeah.
This definitely takes a second, spools up, and you feel it when it's coming on.
Gotcha.
But at the same time, if I'm in day-to-day traffic, other than the whine, I don't even really know it's there until I do get into boost. So it's pretty cool.
So this is your daily driver?
Daily driver.
So what's your gas mileage, man? Because I always ask that. I know it's irrelevant.
So
lot of you guys get on me for asking that question, but I have to ask. What's your gas mileage?
I'll say I don't... It's around, like, I want to say 12 is 13. I mean, the 10-speed auto definitely helps out some and keeping me in a higher gear when I'm just cruising.
Yeah.
I probably put about $20 to $30 in it about three times a week, though.
And three times?
And that's just getting to and from work and then whatever little driving I do out and about. So it definitely, that's one of the sacrifices you make.
That's a huge sacrifice. But, I mean, listen, we're car guys, so we don't care, man. We'll do what it takes to get our car right, man.
Oh, yeah.
So I noticed that you got Corsair exhaust, right?
Yes, yes.
Okay. Did that come factory or was that aftermarket?
That's aftermarket. Went ahead and got the full cat back. So Ford, when they came out with the 2018s, they offered an active exhaust, which had three or four modes. I can't remember. It was like economy mode, track mode, sport mode, race mode, whatever. And they all got louder and what I think more, way more aggressive as you go up the ladder. And I didn't opt for that just for the simple fact that I knew I wanted to put exhaust and make the car my own.
Yeah.
But that is a good option if you do get that package, the factory active exhaust. But this Corsa Extreme, I was a little skeptical at first.
Yeah.
It was known as one of the, if not the loudest ones out for these and a couple other American muscle cars.
Yeah.
But I have really, really enjoyed it. It's,
give it again.
It's been nice.
You got to give us a hard pull eventually.
Oh yeah.
But go ahead. What were you saying?
But it's been great. It is a loud exhaust. It definitely lets you know that that it's around.
Gotcha.
But I do like that it's more of the raspy exhaust versus the low grumble. I mean, I don't mind that, but it's a unique tone. Definitely is.
Now, is it considered active or passive exhaust?
No. Okay. So this is just you get one sound.
Gotcha.
What it is, the active is actually like a flap inside the exhaust, and it opens and closes depending on what mode you have it set in.
Gotcha. So, okay. So all in all, how much would you say you put under the hood of this car, money-wise?
Under the hood.
Yeah. Under the hood, cosmetics, everything and all.
All in all, about right at 20 grand now.
Fuck, that's a whole new car, man.
Yeah. About 20 grand.
Yeah.
That's after getting the car new in April.
Yeah.
Now the turbo kit along that I've got on here, it ran with supporting mods about 11-ish.
Okay.
So that took up a lot of it right there. Then when you factor in the rims and tires, I want to say just the rear tires alone are close to $400 a tire, if I'm not mistaken. So stuff like that adds up. But a lot of the money was simply just put into the force induction system.
Gotcha. So what do you have planned for this car? Are you going to do anything else? I mean, what's next? Because you said you're putting down 660. So I'm assuming you're going for that 700 mark.
So
you're going for Hellcat territory now.
So I definitely want to get long tube headers, catless headers. That's in the future.
Yeah.
I've pretty much done everything suspension-wise. I forgot to mention that earlier. Uh-huh. I've pretty much done everything suspension-wise you can do to the car as far as aftermarket goes. So that's helped out as well to kind of get the car to feeling more like BMW, because that's the crowd I come from.
So you had a BMW before this?
I've had two before this.
Oh, wow.
What
made you get a Mustang, man?
Just the new body style of these, I guess you would say 2015s and up.
Yeah.
And they looked more European and rounded off. And I know, you know, Mustang has a big following, and a lot of those people are diehard pony car fanatics, you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
I love them. I love the older models as well. Yeah. I'm not one of those strict, you know, you don't do anything to a Mustang. And, you know, a lot of people don't necessarily like the newer body style, I guess.
Yeah.
But I'm a huge fan just because it does remind me of a more European track car inspired design versus just a straight line car. And that just personal opinion. That's what I like.
Absolutely. So one question I always ask is, if you had your choice at any other car, would you have still chosen a Ford Mustang, or would you have chosen something else? Because, you know, there's a lot of cars on the market now that's really powerful coming right out the gate. And then, of course, they just came out with the GT500.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? Would you have stuck with the 5.0, or would you have waited and got a 500, or would you have tried something else completely different, a Chevy, a Dodge, or back to BMW?
Okay. So if at the time... Yes, at the time, this car was the perfect fit. I wanted something brand new. I wanted something reliable. That if it did break, you know, knock on wood, it wouldn't cost me an arm and a leg to repair it. You know, if anything went out on that BMW, I was paying a lot more than anything going out on this car.
Yeah.
In a perfect world with more money and. You know, as I grow in life, I think my dream car, I know this sounds kind of like basic, but definitely a GTR or a Corvette ZR1.
Godzilla,
I've always wanted one of those. I think now, after driving an American car, I might lean heavier towards the ZR1.
Yeah.
Even with this car, though, my plan, I've got a little over 15,000 miles on it right now.
Yeah.
My plan is in the next maybe 3 years or whatnot, once I hit around the, let's say, 60,000 mark on the car, I think I'm going to look into doing like a twin turbo build on it.
Shit.
And obviously it won't be my daily at that point, but I like to get it to be a 900, 1,000 plus horsepower car and just have it as my weekend, you know, take to car meets and whatnot.
900 horsepower Ford Mustang.
That'd be fun. In a 10-speed auto, too. Definitely have to
That's
do
crazy.
Some tweaking, you know, with transmission bits and whatnot.
Oh, but, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. But man, I really appreciate this, man. Yeah. I appreciate the opportunity, man. I'm the kind of guy where I love all cars.
Yes, sir.
You know, Dodge, Chevy, Ford, BMW, I love everything, and it's an honor and a privilege to be able to sit in something else and try something else, man. It's really spacious in here, too.
Yeah, it is pretty roomy. Not
I like
the back,
this. It's a lot more roomy than a Camaro, to be honest.
Really? Okay.
A lot more roomy.
I've been in Matt's.
I've been in Matt's.
In the driver's seat.
Yeah. But. I've been in Matt's and Griff's ZL1, and I've been in, you know, just SS and stuff like that. It's really tight. You know what I'm saying? Can you see it all back here?
I can see.
We got louvers on the back, too.
Yeah. I mean, I've heard the Camaros do have some blind spots. Yeah. Obviously, I've got some, too, for
Camaros
the simple
got
fact
huge blind
I
spots.
Did throw louvers on the quarter windows.
Yeah.
Obviously, honestly, it doesn't bother me that much. Gotcha. Rearview mirrors, the front windows are plenty big enough where I don't consider this car having many. I've had a 370Z in the past, and that car I feel like was a lot more out of shape when it comes to blind spots than this one.
Gotcha. Well, all right, man. I appreciate you guys for tuning in, man. As always, it's been my man Adam here.
Hey.
I'm going to make sure to put all of his information down in the description, man. This is the guy. He's the biggest Ford Mustang guy in Charlotte, man. Trust me when I say. He may not be there right now, but he's going to. Oh, you can hear it. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. This man is crazy. 600. Oh, we got an open lane now.
Hold on. I'm going to slow it down a little.
Slow it down.
We're already going.
Oh, yeah. That's power. That's 660 horsepower right there, ladies and gentlemen. On that note, we're going to go ahead and get out of here before we get fucking pulled over by a state trooper. He just got pulled over this past week and was lucky. But with that being said, like,
we're across the border.
Exactly. That's right. We're not in Charlotte anymore. We're in Mexico, man. But as always, like, subscribe, comment, man. Talk to your boy. Tell me how you feel, man. I'm going to put all this information in the description. And we're going to go from there, man. As always, take it easy, and I'll see you in the next one.